Do you have something you want to say? You're looking at me like you got something you want to say. I'm only going to ask you one more time, son. Do you have anything you want to say?
Yeah, Warden. As a matter of fact, there are some things I want to say. I'd like to thank my friends. And my family. And I'd like to thank my guru. And everybody else that's helped me get through all this. And for the rest of this world, well, you can kiss my ever-loving ass. Because I'm innocent. And for those people responsible for my murder tonight, you know who you are. Well, I got some words for you too. But I put those in a letter. Something for you to look forward to tomorrow.
Since the beginning of recorded time, mankind has found itself wedged between the forces of good and evil. Millions of lives have been sacrificed over the simple question about whose God actually exists. Century after century, bloodbath after bloodbath, the question persists. But there is one fact about which all warriors of the gods agree. They agree that a dark force exists and dwells within and around us. A dark force whose powers seem limitless and always evil. A dark force whose name seems not to matter, as it shapeshifts from one entity to another. A dark force who all fear, yet inexplicably, are drawn toward. A dark force recognized and celebrated worldwide. In America, we celebrate this force on Halloween night. Each year we let down our guard and allow this dark force gently into the minds of even our children. One might ask, what better night for the forces of good and evil to clash? On Halloween 1981, in the small Midwestern city of Amarillo, Texas, residents not only feared such a clash, but expected it. While most Texans celebrated Halloween with their children without fear or panic, in Amarillo, a different story was unfolding. A story of how the forces of good and evil were on a collision course, which would result in a gruesome tale of murder, remorse, and regret. As children laughed and danced from door to door that Halloween night, mothers and fathers prayed the night would end without incident. Worried they were, but not for their children. Instead, they feared for their grandmothers and their mothers. Why? Because a serial rapist and killer stalked their town. His chosen prey, helpless, elderly women. Innocent souls he raped, strangled, and then mutilated. Amarillo's collective fear turned real that Halloween. The killer's next victim, Sister Tadea Benz, attacked while she slept in her bedroom at the St. Francis Convent. The 76-year-old Franciscan nun was brutally beaten, raped, strangled, and mutilated in the exact same manner as the elderly victim before her, Narnie Box Bryson. Mrs. Bryson lived just a few blocks from Sister Benz. Veteran homicide detective Claude Stevens was selected to join a 5-member multi-agency task force set up specifically to solve the Bryson and Benz murder.
There were a couple of homicides that happened fairly close. An elderly lady by the name of Narnie Bryson and then an elderly nun by the name of Sister Tadea Benz. The police department was under a lot of pressure because the community was concerned, especially when Miss Bryson died and then not too many days later or weeks, then they had the loss of Sister Benz. Something needed to be done and something needed to happen to calm the community, to get them over this fear that all the senior citizen ladies were going to be raped and murdered in the city of Amarillo.
Attorney John Terry worked as the chief felony prosecutor for the Potter County District Attorney's Office.
After the news of the Tadea Benz killing came out, and we realized we had a big one on our hands, we had a problem. I would say at first in our district attorney's office, particularly among the rank and file, the guys who were working the courts and prepping the cases, was shock, almost disbelief. It was, someone did what? Someone killed a nun in her place? You've got to be kidding me.
The nun's killer gained entry through a cut screen and the jagged glass of a window in the back of the convent. He crept quietly up a stairwell, down a hallway, past the bedroom of other nuns, and into Sister Benz's room. Bishop Leroy Mathiason presided over the diocese at the time of Sister Benz's murder.
I got a call on a Sunday morning. Halloween was on a Saturday that year, and I was told that she had been murdered. They had mass every morning, I believe, at 6:30, and she always, of course, showed up and participated. That morning, she did not. So eventually, one of the older sisters went to look for her and found her on the floor and came back and reported that.
Semen was found in vaginal fluids taken from the nun, fingerprints, black curly hairs, and blood, possibly from the murderer, were also found. As he'd done in the Bryson murder, the killer left behind his white shirt, crumpled on the floor beside the victim's bed.
I think the timing of the incident probably did add to the fears because, you know, even I remember thinking myself at some time, well, I wonder if this is some kind of cult deal where some group has got together and said, wouldn't it be nice if we could kill a nun on Halloween and nobody would ever know who did it? You know, you have all kinds of things that run through your mind simply because of the, what they call All Hallows' Eve, the celebration of death and things of that nature. But in this particular case, since it was so closely related to the other death of Miss Bryson, then I think the date did have maybe imposed a little more fear on the public.
Attorney Jeff Blackburn is the director of the Innocence Project at Texas Tech University's Law School.
Well, it's kind of interesting to reflect on what the mood here was like. There was hysteria and anger, but not very compassionate anger. It was lynch mob anger. Strictly light the torches and go assault the castle, believe me. People were strictly on in lynch mob mode at that time.
The city of Amarillo was crippled by an incurable plague of violence. Rewards increased daily, as though throwing cash at the problem would result in a miraculous cure.